Hello friends, in this video let us solve previous year electronic science paper which was conducted by Karnataka State Eligibility Test. If you are not yet subscribed to my channel, then do subscribe to my channel and turn on the bell icon to get instant notification whenever I upload a new video. Also join my Telegram group, the links are provided in the description. Hello friends, in this video let us solve 75 MCQ questions. Starting with first question, what is the high resistance reading in both forward and reverse direction indicates? First option what they have given is a good diode, second option an open diode, third option a shorted diode, fourth one is defective ohmmeter. In the case of good diode means a normal diode. A normal diode, when it is forward bias, its resistance will be a low value. Its resistance will be a low value. When it is reverse bias, its resistance will be an high value. Its resistance will be an high value. So good diode can't be an option. Let us take shorted diode. A shorted diode is a one where the terminals are shorted. So in this case, under both forward bias as well as in reverse bias, its resistance will be a low value. Hence third option can't be true. Fourth option and second option is a confusing one. Second option what they are given is open diode. What do you mean by open diode? It is not having any meaning. Fourth option what they are given is a defective ohmmeter. A defective ohmmeter is the one in which if you are measuring, its resistance will be more or an high value irrespective of forward and reverse condition. So the suitable option that is going to follow is option D is correct. Second question what they have given is, they have given electron mobility as mu n equals to 0.36. And also they have given the carrier lifetime which is equals to 340 microseconds. We know that diffusion length L equals to under root of mu n times of tau n, which is equals to under root of 0.36 into 340 micro. So which is 1.77 millimeter. That is option B is correct. Third question what they have given is, for a BJT, two cases they have given. In the first case, early effect VA equals to 100 volts and VCE which is equals to 10 volts. For this, what is the value of IC? And in the next case, what they have made is, they have made VA, nothing but early effect which is equals to infinite. So in this case, what is the value of IC? Let me call this current as IC dash and VCE as VCA dash and VA as VA dash. How I can calculate current? Current is given by IC equals to 1 plus VCE divided by VA. 1 plus VCE divided by VA, which is equals to 1 plus VCE, nothing but 10 divided by 100, which is equals to 1.1. So I got IC equals to 1.1. In the next case, IC dash I have to calculate, which is given by 1 plus VCE dash divided by VA dash. We know that VCE dash we don't know, but VA dash is infinite, which is 1. So based on this, if I'm calculating the percentage change, how can I calculate percentage change? Percentage change is given by IC dash difference IC divided by IC dash, which is equals to 1.1 difference 1 divided by 1 into 100%, because percentage means always you have to express in 100% only, which is 10%. That is option A is correct. Fourth question what they have given is, they have given a network function which is having zeros only on the left half of S plane. Now look at over here, this is the S plane. If zeros are residing on the left half of S plane, then it is a minimum phase system. If one zero is residing on right half of S plane, then it is a non-minimum system. So this is with respect to zero. Now if I'm talking about poles, if all the poles are on the left half of S plane, then the system is stable. If one pole is on the right half of S plane, then my system is an unstable system. If I'm having a simple pole or a repeated pole on an imaginary axis, then the system will be marginally stable. On the imaginary axis, if there are repeated poles, then the system will be an unstable system. So for this, option C is correct. Fifth question, What they are asking you to find is, they are asking us to find the current I in this branch. So how to solve is, you can make use of nodal analysis, or you can make use of mesh analysis, or you can go with source transformation. So I'll be solving with both source transformation as well as nodal analysis. So the 60 volts and 100 ohms is a practical voltage source. I'm going to convert into a practical current source. So what is the value I'll be getting is 0.6 amperes and 100 ohms. My idea is this 120, I'm going to somehow reduce, and I'm going to convert this entire thing into a current source back to voltage source. This current source I'm going to convert into a voltage source, and then I'm going to solve. And this 100 and 20 will be in parallel. So the equivalent value will be 100 into 20 divided by 120, which is 25s are, 26 are, 2 3s are, 2 10s are. So the equivalent value of resistance will be 50 by 3. Next, the current source value is 0.6 amperes and the resistance value is 50 by 3, nothing but 6 divided by 10 is the current value, and 50 by 3 is my resistance value, which is 10 volts, which is 10 volts. So the equivalent circuit is, I'll be having a 10 volt battery. In series to this, I'll be having a 50 by 3 ohm resistor. Again, I'll be having a 10 ohm resistor. I'll be having a 10 ohm resistor, and I'll be having a 6 ohm. If I'm converting this 15 ampere 4 ohms into a voltage source, I'll be getting 10 ohms. And what is 15 fours are 60. 15 fours are 60 volts. Able to follow? And one resistor I'll be having over here, that is 20 ohm. That is 20 ohm. This node is a principal node. Let me assume to be at ground potential, and let me apply nodal analysis at Vx. Let me call this node voltage as Vx. Let me assume all these currents are leaving this node. This current is Vx minus 10 divided by, what is the resistance involved in this path? That is 50 by 3 plus 10, which is 80 divided by 3. That is, I can write it as multiplied by 3. Plus, what is the download current? It is Vx divided by 20. Vx divided by 20. Plus, what is the write current? It is Vx minus 60 divided by 10, which is equals to 0. Which is equals to 0. On taking the LCM, what I'll be getting is 3Vx minus 30 plus 4 times of Vx plus 8 times of Vx minus 480, which is equals to 0. I'm getting Vx equals to 34 volts. I'm getting Vx equals to 34 volts. How I can express current high? How I can express current high means, I equals to 10 minus 34 divided by 80 by 3, which is minus 0.9 amperes. The close answer is 0 amperes, but KSET board, they have released the key answer as 2 amperes. Sixth question, a reciprocal network is described by Z21 equals to S square divided by 3S square plus 2 and Z22 equals to S square plus 4S divided by 3S square plus 2. Its transmission zeros are located at, directly you can tell it is located at 0, plus or minus J2, which is option number C is correct. Moving on to seventh question, what they have given is the percentage voltage regulation of a voltage supply providing 100 volts unloaded and 95 volts of full loaded. Nothing but they have given V no load, nothing but under no load condition, the voltage what you are getting is 100 volts. Under full load condition, we are getting 95 volts. So the percentage voltage regulation, we know that it is given by V no load minus V full load divided by V full load into 100%. So what is the value of V no load? V no load equals to 100 minus, what is the value of V full load? That is 95 divided by V full load is 95 into 100%. Since they are asking us to express in terms of percentage, you have to write multiply by 100. So the value what you will be getting is 5 divided by 95 into 100%. So the answer what you will be getting is 5.26, which is close to 5.3. Option number C is going to follow. Moving on to 8th question, what they have given is, what starts a free running multivibrator? Free running multivibrator is nothing but a stable multivibrator. Free running multivibrator is nothing but a stable multivibrator. In this unstable multivibrator, we are going to generate clock pulses. We are going to generate clock pulses and we are going to realize this one with the help of 555 timer IC. Able to follow? The block diagram of 555 timer IC will be, you will be having two resistors. I'm going to call the resistors as RA and RB, and you will be having a capacitor. Let me call this capacitor as C. Pin number 2 and pin number 6 are shorted and it is connected over here, and pin number 7 is connected between RA and RB, and pin number 4 and pin number 8 is connected to VDD. So the what is the value of VDD means you will be giving 5 volts battery. Since it's a 555 timer, you are going to give DC of 5 volt. Pin number 5 is connected to ground via a capacitor. The value of this capacitor is 0.01 microfarad. So pin number 5 is connected to ground via capacitor, and pin number 1 is directly connected to ground. Pin number 3 is taken as output pin. And the voltage across this capacitor is treated as input. Now look at over here. For this circuit, you will not be giving any trigger pulses. There is no input. There is no external circuitry. So what starts a free running multivibrator means you can adjust the duty cycle of the clock based on RA, RB and C value. Moving on to 9th question, what they have given is, they have given the open loop gain as 1200 and CMRR they have specified as 55 dB. We know that how you can express CMRR in dB, which is equals to 20 log of differential gain to common mode gain, nothing but 20 log of AD divided by ACM. The value of CMRR what they have given is 55. If I want to express in terms of normal form, it is 20 log of CMRR, which is equals to 55 in dB. So this 55 divided by 20, which is equals to log of CMRR base 10. So how I can express is, CMRR is given by 10 power of 55 divided by 20, which is equals to 10 power of 2.75, which is 562. So the closest answer is option number B is going to follow. 10th question, what they have given is, you have to realize XOR gate given the inputs X and Y, and you will not be having complement inputs, nothing but X bar and Y bar is not available. So if you are having only X and Y inputs, nothing but you will be having only uncomplemented inputs. At that time, if you want to realize XOR gate with the help of NAND gates, how many NAND gates are required is the question. So when you have realized NAND gate as an universal gates, at that time you have realized XOR gate using NAND gate, XNOR gate using NAND gate, all those things you have discussed. So if you want to realize XOR gate, let me call my output as Z. Z equals to X XOR with Y. If you want to realize XOR gate with the help of NAND gates, how many NAND gates are required? You are in need of 4 NAND gates. Hence, option number C is going to follow. 11th question, output of the following circuit is. So in order to realize this circuit, what we need is, we should know the true table of XOR gate. Let me assume my inputs are A and B. If my inputs are 0, 0, output is 0. If my inputs are 0, 1, output is 1. If my inputs are 1, 0, output is still 1. If my inputs are 1, 1, output is 0. Nothing but for unequal inputs, my output is 1. For equal inputs, output is 0. X XOR with X, output is 0. 0 XOR with X, nothing but X only. X XOR with X will be 0. So I'll be getting output Z equals to 0, nothing but option A is going to follow. 12th question, a ring counter closely resembles. Let me implement a 3-bit ring counter. So you'll be having a first flip-flop, second flip-flop and third flip-flop. Let me consider D flip-flop for the convenience, and you will be having a clock. Let me give
clock over here. Since it is a synchronous circuit, I am going to give a common clock for all the three flip-flops. The output of the first flip-flop will be given as input for the next, and it propagates. The output of the last flip-flop is fed as the input to the first flip-flop in the case of ring counter. In the case of twisted or Johnson counter, you are going to tap Q bar. You are going to tap Q bar and then you are going to give it D. So this ring counter is similar to shift register. This ring counter is similar to shift register because the data is propagated like this. Right? So the suitable option is option number C is correct. 13th question. In 8086, if the contents of code segment register is 1FAB, so the content of code segment they have given as 1FAB in hexadecimal, and they have given the instruction pointer value equals to 10A1H. They are asking us to calculate the effective address that is given by EA. We know that effective address is given by code segment register value multiplied by 10 in hexadecimal or 16 plus offset. Plus offset. Nothing but segment register multiplied by 10H plus offset. What is the segment registers I have taken? I have taken code segment, but what is the code segment value? It is 1FAB multiplied by 10H will be 0. Plus, what is the offset I have taken? Instruction pointer, that is IP. What is the value of instruction pointer? What is it pointing for? 10A1. If I am solving, I will be getting 20B51H. That is option D is correct. If you have not yet liked my video, please give it a big thumbs up. Also share this video with your friends. 14th question. What they have given is, first statement is push AX. So the AX is having a value 20H. And next is push BX. BX will be having a value of 34H. So the first data is been pushed to stack, that is 20H. Next data will be pushed, that is 34H. Third instruction, what you're doing is you're going to pop into AX register, nothing but this 34, you're going to pop into AX register. So this 20 becomes 34. This 20 becomes 34. Next, what you're doing is you're going to add AX comma BX. Now, what is the value of AX? That is 34. What is the value of BX? That is also 34, which is 68. This data will be stored in AX register only. This data will be stored in AX register only. Two times you have done push operations. So you have to do two times pop operation also. The next pop, if you're doing, you are getting 20H. So this 20H you're going to get in G register. So G is going to have a value of 20H. Hence, the suitable option is option A is correct. 15th question, if you are executing sub B instruction, then which and all the flags will get affected? Subtraction with borrow. Say suppose if I am doing 3 minus 6 is first example, 3 minus 3 is second example, 6 minus 3 is third example. So if you are considering 3 minus 6 at the time, you are in need of borrow. Borrow means carry flag will be affected. Able to follow? Next, in this case, the result will be non-zero. The result will be non-zero. In this case, result will be equals to 0. At the time, 0 flag will be set to 1. So 0 flag will get affected. Next, 3 minus 6 if you are performing, the result will be a negative value. But here it is positive and here also it is positive. So the sign flag gets affected. Sign flag value, if it is 1, nothing but if MSB is 1, then the result what you got is negative. The negative number will be stored in 2's complement form. If sign flag is holding a value 0, nothing but the result is a positive value. If I am talking about parity flag, nothing but it talks about 8 bit lower register contents, right? So based on 8 bit register lower contents, if it is having odd number of ones and even number of ones, based on this, parity flag is set or reset. So all the flags are getting affected. Hence, option D is correct. Moving on to 16th question, which of the following is not a valid mathematical function in C? First option, fr exponent of x, what it is going to do is it is going to convert the floating point value to fraction and exponent. So the floating point value you are going to convert into fraction and exponent. A tan 2 means arc tangent of y divided by x. Arc tangent of y divided by x you are going to perform. Basically this one you are going to use in MATLAB. SRAND means if you want to generate a random number, at that time you are going to make use of SRAND. And what is the use of fmod? Fmod, if you're doing, it is nothing but double of y divided by double of x. Nothing but if you're performing 5.0 divided by 3.0. If you're doing, what is the remainder? Remainder is 2. So if you're performing fmod of x, then you'll be getting the result value as 2. Able to follow? So based on this, I can tell option B is not valid in C because this one will be used in MATLAB. 17th question, comment on the output of the following C program. What they have given is hash include library files, all those things they have given. Int A value is initialized to 1. Size of, what is the size of an integer? It is going to take 2 bytes. Character 1 byte. And float 4 bytes it is going to take, all those things you should remember. So size of A, if I'm writing, it is 2 bytes. Size of A means 2 bytes, plus plus A means the value of A should be incremented. Nothing but 1 is going to become 2. So this statement, if you're executing, you'll be getting 2. Next, this statement, what it says is value of A you are printing. What is the new value of A? It is 2. So the option that is going to follow is option C is correct, because A is initialized to 1. First step, you are going to do pre-increment operation, and say in the second step, you are going to print the value. In the first step, the size of an integer remains same, that it is going to take 2 bytes. Based on this, I can tell option C is correct. 18th question, predict the data type of the following mathematical operation in C language. We know that if you are using 293, this is an integer, but if you are using 2.0, directly you can tell it is a floating point representation. In the case of floating point representation also, you can represent this 293. So in turn, your compiler, what it is going to do is it is going to read it as 2.0, 9.0 and 3.0, and option C is correct. 19th question. The question is based on microwaves and radar. In gun oscillator, where the diode is operated in tunable resonant circuit, most of the sample length of the gun diode is maintained in the negative conductance state during most of RF cycle for LSA mode, hence option C is correct. In the case of rectangular waveguide, they are asking dominant mode. We know that in the case of rectangular waveguide, nothing but in transverse electric, it is TE10. In the case of transverse electromagnetic or in transverse magnetic, it is TM11. So these are all dominant mode. So in the case of dominant mode, you should know what do you mean by cutoff frequency and what do you mean by cutoff wavelength. In the case of cutoff frequency, you are going to talk about lowest frequency that it can propagate. Here you are going to consider highest wavelength beyond which the wave can't propagate. So these two things you should know. So based on this, I can tell option A is correct. 21st question, in a reflex klystron, the velocity modulation occurs accelerating grid. So option C is correct. 22nd question, this is based on analog communication. Capture effect is the characteristics of AM, FM, PCM and FDM. FDM stands for frequency division multiplexing. So capture effect is seen in FM. The bandwidth of n-bit binary coded PCM for modulating a signal having a bandwidth of f hertz is, first option f by n, second option f by n square, third option n times of f, fourth option n square times of f hertz. We know it is n times of f hertz, hence option number C is correct. 24th question, in a pulse code modulation system, Each quantization level is encoded into 8 bits. The signal to quantization noise ratio is equals to, we know that SQNR, which is equals to 10 log of 1.5 into 2 power of 2n. So the formulas you have to remember, which is 10 log of 1.5 into what is n, which is 8. So it is 2 power 16. So this value I'll be getting 49.28, which is roughly equals to 48 dB. Hence option B is correct. 25th question, one of the following devices can be used as relaxation oscillator. First option SCR, second option TRIAC, third option BJT, fourth option UJT. We know that UJT, nothing but unijunction transistor, will be acting like a relaxation oscillator. So UJT will be having a negative resistance. So this negative resistance is seen in UJT as well as in tunnel diode also. 26th question, in a SCR circuit, if anode is grounded, the voltages at the gate and cathode at a particular working condition are measured to be minus 50 volts and minus 55 volts respectively. Based on these observations, it could be inferred at. So you'll be having a SCR. SCR is made up of two PNPN junction. Able to follow? The symbolic representation of an SCR will be like this. So you'll be having anode terminal and you'll be having a cathode terminal, and this is gate terminal. Able to follow? First option, what they have given is the SCR is in forward blocking mode. The SCR is in forward blocking mode. This one can't be a correct answer, because if it wants to be in a forward blocking mode, if you're not applying any gate pulses, if you are giving anode as positive and cathode as negative, or the voltage difference between anode and cathode should be roughly equals to 1000 volts. Roughly equals to 1000 volts. This much huge value you can't apply. So what you're going to do is you're going to inject a current pulse. So this case, SCR is not in a forward blocking mode. SCR is in conducting mode, they are telling. See, the voltage drop across over here is now, it is just 50 volts. It is just 50 volts over here, because cathode terminal you have applied minus 50 and across gate you are giving minus 55 and you are giving a negative current over here, right? So SCR is in conducting mode is wrong. SCR is in reverse blocking mode, up to some extent it is correct. SCR may get damaged, yes, because here you have to inject positive current. But what is the current you are injecting? You are injecting a reverse current. So SCR is going to get damaged, and it is also in reverse blocking mode, but it is more reverse blocking mode, hence it leads to damage of an SCR. In optical fiber communication, FBG is used for. FBG means fiber back grating. It is used for what they are asking. Say suppose, consider you are having an optical fiber cable. Say this cable you are stretching or you are compressing. What is the thing that is going to happen is the refractive index of the core is going to vary. So when the refractive index of the core is varied, each and every thing is getting varied. Nothing but dispersion is going to take place. So in order to measure the level of dispersion, or in order to compensate for the things, we are going to make use of FBG. Hence the suitable option is option D is correct. 28th question, in wire wound strain gauge, the change in resistance is due to. What do you mean by strain? Strain is nothing but change in the dimension divided by actual dimension. If I'm talking about resistor, it is delta R divided by R. If I'm talking about a length, it is delta L divided by length. If I'm talking about some parameters, so I can write it as delta P divided by P. So the change in resistance is due to change in both length and diameter, because how I can express R? R equals to rho L divided by A, where R is resistance and rho is resistivity, L is the length of the conductor and A is the area of the cross section that is involved. 29th question, you have to calculate the arithmetic mean of the measurement. They have given 6 observations. Let me write all 6 observations. The first one is 12.8, second one is 12.2, the third one is 12.5, 13.1, 12.9, and 12.4. If I'm adding all these values, I'll be getting 10, 16, 25, 29, 4, 6, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, and I'll be getting 75.9. The 75.9 is the total value divided by number of observations will be 6. So the mean value I'll be getting 12.65 milliamperes. That is option B is correct. 30th question. In a control system, integral error compensation minimizes the steady state error. The basic concepts of proportional controller, integral controller, derivative controller, PI, PD, PID, all those things you should know. So based on this, option B is correct. 31st question, which of the following is our valid statements? Carbon is used as it does not belong to fourth group of periodic table. Wrong. Carbon belongs to fourth group element. Even though it belongs to fourth group element, carbon acts like an insulator. We know that all the fourth group elements are semiconductor. The exception case is carbon. The atomic number of carbon is 6. Gallium arsenide is used as semiconductor and it does not belong to fourth group. It is true. Gallium arsenide, gallium belongs to third group and arsenic belongs to fifth group. So the combination of third group and fifth group is zinc blend. Not only third group and fifth group, even it can be second group and sixth group also, or it can be first group and seventh group also. So based on this, the second option, what second statement what they have given is correct. Silicon is widely used as it is cheaper than germanium. Up to some extent it is a correct statement. Germanium is still used in low voltage devices. Yes. Why silicon is preferred is it is having low leakage current. Hence, we are going to make use of silicon, right? So based on this, I can tell 2, 3, 4 is correct. Hence, option number D is correct. 32nd question, what they have given is, which of the following statements are a valid statement? First option, what they have given is, maximum power transfer theorem yields equivalent voltage source, which is a false statement. Thevenin's theorem yields equivalent voltage source, yes. Now, if you are having a bilateral network, the entire thing will be converted into a equivalent voltage source or single voltage source. That one you are going to call it as a Thevenin's voltage, and the resistance looking at that end, that one you are going to call it as a Thevenin's impedance, and across this one you are going to connect a load impedance, that is ZL. So superposition theorem gives current equivalent circuit. It is wrong. Superposition theorem means it is additive of each and individual response that is added together. Norton theorem means what it is going to yield is, it is going to yield a equivalent current source, and that current you're going to call it as a Norton current or a short circuit current, and you're going to connect a Norton resistance in parallel. This Norton resistance is equals to Thevenin's resistance. Across this you're going to connect a load impedance, that is ZL. Make sure, remember, this Thevenin's equivalent circuit and Norton's equivalent circuit are dual to each other. So 2 and 4 is correct, nothing but option B is going to follow. 33rd question, you have to identify the following configuration with voltage gain. We know that in the case of common emitter, we will be having negative times of output divided by input. This negative indicates it is a phase shift of 180 degree. So common emitter also provides a voltage gain, but the phase shift will be 180 degree, and common base will also produce a phase shift of 0 degree or 360 degree, nothing but it is not going to produce any phase shift. And if I am talking about gain in the case of common base and gain in the case of common emitter, gain in the case of common base is more when compared to gain in the case of common emitter. And common collector and common emitter, this is something like one and the same. The gain is of the order of 0.98 roughly you can approximate to one, nothing but these two things is not going to offer any voltage gain. Only one and two, nothing but common emitter and common base is going to offer voltage gain. So option B is going to follow. 34th question, which of the following is our valid statement? First statement, what they have given is JK flip-flop is an example of synchronous sequential circuit. If you are having only one flip-flop, you can't tell it is falling under synchronous design or asynchronous design. If you are having multiple flip-flops, based on the clock connections, if simultaneously if you are applying the clock pulse, then it is a synchronous design. If output of the previous state is fed as input for the next state and that one is acting like a clock, then it is asynchronous design. So based on only one flip-flop, I can't tell it is falling under synchronous or asynchronous. Second option, what they have given is decoder requires clock for its operation. No, decoder does not require clock for the operation because decoder is a combinational circuit. NAND gate is a universal gate. Yes, if I am telling NAND gate is an universal gate, that means you can implement all basic gates or any given expression with the help of NAND gates. And multiplexer is also an universal gate. Yes, not only multiplexer is an universal gate, even NOR gate is an universal gate, NAND gate is an universal gate, MUX is a universal gate, DMUX is also an universal gate. I have explained in detail how demultiplexer is acting like an universal gate. If you have not watched the video, links are given in the description. Also, you can click on I button also. And you will be having encoders and decoders. This one will be acting like an universal gate. Also, you will be having a ACE gate. So all these are universal gate. If you are considering AND gate plus OR gate plus NOT gate, if all these gates are available, then this is also an universal gate. Based on this, third statement and fourth statement is correct. Nothing but option C is going to follow. 35th question, what they have given is, which of the following is our valid statement? First option, what they have given is 8086 as direction flag. Yes, 8086 is having direction flag. Say suppose you want to transfer a bulk data from one path to another path. Say suppose if I'm considering this one as source and this one as destination. If I'm making DF equals to zero, if I'm pointing a pointer over here and pointer over here, then all this data will be transferred to destination, right? If I'm making DF equals to one, then all this data will be transferred to source. This is the working principle of direction flag. 8255 can be used as a counter. No, 8255 is used for interfacing, and mainly it is for interfacing with slower peripherals. Slower peripherals. You have conducted an experiment, nothing but stepper motor, DC motor, LCD driver, all these things. You are going to make use of 8255 and then you are going to drive the external circuitry. 8085 will be having the queue, yes, but they are telling it is first in first out. No, it will be having a last in first out concept or first in last out concept. So this statement is a false statement. 8086 will be having an inbuilt counter. It will be having a 16-bit counter and that is CX. Also, it will be having an 8-bit counter, that is CL or CH. So this is 8-bit counter. 16-bit counters are CX, 8-bit counters are CL and CH. This is default counter. Also, you can make AX, BX, CX, DX as a counter. But at that time, you have to make use of decrement jump if not zero or jump if not zero instructions. But if I'm talking about a built-in counter, that is CX is an 18-bit counter and CL or CH is an 8-bit counter. So based on this, first statement and fourth statement is correct. Nothing but option A is going to follow. 36th question, which of the following is our valid statement? Do while is a entry control loop. So do, you have written some statement and then you are going to end with like while of some condition you are going to specify over here at last semicolon. The semicolon you have to give only in do while. For while you are not going to give this semicolon. This is very, very important. So in the case of do while, first you are going to execute this program and then you are going to check the condition. So it is entry control they are telling. Sorry, it is not an entry controlled. while of one is a finite loop they are telling. No, while of true means you should execute. While of one is an infinite loop. So one and two statements are wrong. External variables are alive and active in the entire program. It is true. Compound relation expression are used to test more than one condition in logical expression with operators. Yes. So third statement and fourth statements are correct. Nothing but option A is going to follow. 37th question, you have to find which is the valid statement. Gun diode is not a TED, transferred electron device. We know that gun diode is a TED, but they are telling it is not a TED. So this option is wrong. Gun diode is bulk semiconductor device. Yes. Gun diode exhibits negative resistance. This is very, very important. Gun diode is used for rectification is wrong. Gun diode can't be used as rectification. Hence, statement 2 and statement 3 is correct. Nothing but option A is going to follow. Anyway, statement 4 you can neglect because in none of the option, statement 4 they have specified. 38th question, again you have to find which is the valid statement. First statement what they have given is, short noise is found in transistor device. Yes. Noise can be completely removed by a local oscillator. No. Say suppose if you are having a modulated frequency as FC plus FM, if you want only FM, at that time what you are going to do is you are going to make use of a local oscillator and then you are going to give FC over here. So this signal you are going to pass through band pass filter. So the output over here will be FC plus FM plus FC, and another value will be FC plus FM minus FC. So here you can make use of band pass filter, or even you can make use of a low pass filter also. So statement 2 is wrong. Johnson noise is due to load resistance. Yes. Super heterodyne receiver or super heterodyne operation increases signal to noise ratio. So it increases signal to noise ratio. So 1, 3, 4 statement is correct. Nothing but option B is going to follow. Strictly speaking, super heterodyne operation decreases the signal to noise ratio, but none of the option is going to follow. 1 and 3 is correct. So I have to forcefully opt for option B. 39th question, you should know what is the difference between a LED and a laser. So LED is a spontaneous emission device. So laser is a stimulated emission. So first statement is wrong. Pin diode is spontaneous emission device. Yes. Single mode fiber is best suited for long distance communication. Yes, because interference is less. Single fiber with 1.5 micrometer. This is absolutely a wrong statement. So this statement, though, if they are giving some round figures, you can directly throw the answer as wrong. So based on this, 2 and 3 is correct. Nothing but option C is going to follow. 40th question, you have to identify the valid statement. Proportional derivative controls are used for fast response system. Yes. Proportional derivative controls has to be used with proportional controller. No, this statement doesn't make any sense. On-off controller are best suitable for accurate measurement or controller systems. Yes, you can tell. But kitchen refrigerators uses PID controllers, they are telling. It is going to make use of PA controllers. Hence, first and third statement is correct. Nothing but option D is going to follow. 41st to 50th question is based on assertion and reasoning. 41st question, in a semiconductor at high temperature, the avalanche breakdown is going to take place. We will be having a Zener breakdown. At high temperature means lots of collisions will be there. At that time, you require large electric field for impact ionization. So this statement is correct. Nothing but option D is going to follow. 42nd question is based on Laplace transform and Z transforms. Laplace transform is time domain to frequency domain, nothing but S to J omega, and Z transforms is a discrete domain of frequency domain. So it is a discrete version of Laplace domain. So assertion is correct. Z transforms is a transform of time domain to a frequency domain for discrete time signal. So it is also correct. In the Z transforms, you're going to replace Zd equals to e power j omega. You're going to replace Zd equals to e power j omega. This is a discrete signal. 43rd question, virtual ground exists only for op amps with infinite open loop gain. Yes, it is correct. And also there should not be any saturation. At that time only, virtual ground is valid. Virtual ground is a ground for voltage but not current. Virtual ground is valid for both current as well as for voltage. At any node if you are considering, at that node current will be equals to zero. So based on this, if I am telling, option C is going to follow. 44th question, CMOS logic family consumes least power among all other logic families. This assertion is correct. What reason it is telling is, it is based on construction. Yes, you'll be having a VDD rail and you'll be having a VSS rail or a ground rail, right? So between VDD and Vout, you'll be having a pull-up network. And between Vout and ground, you'll be having a pull down network. Pull up network is realized with the help of PMOS transistors, and pull down network is realized with the help of NMOS transistors. Whenever PMOS transistors are on, NMOS transistors will be off. Whenever PMOS transistors are off, at that time NMOS transistors will be on. Both will be turned on only at the transitions. So answer is option A. 8085 can handle 16 bit data. It is wrong. 8085 has 16 bit AZU. Yes, so answer is option D. Branch instructions are most powerful instruction as they allow the microprocessor to change the sequence. Yes, to change the sequence, this assertion is correct. Interrupt can change the sequence of the program. Interrupt also are called as branching statements. Yes. Now look at over here, you are executing the statement. Suddenly if interrupt occurs, it will be going to the ISR. If it is a priority interrupt, it is going to serve the interrupt and then it is going to come back and then it is going to execute the next instruction. So here branching took place. So this statement is also a true statement. Branching instructions are most powerful as they allow the microprocessor to change the sequence of a program. Yes, interrupts also change the sequence they are telling. So here branching instructions, here interrupts. So this statement is the correct explanation for this branching instruction. Hence option A is correct. 47th question, in a microwave communication link, rain causes fading and this is a great concern in communication channel or in the communication system. Yes, water droplets in the path of an electromagnetic wave will scatter the energy in the waves, and this collective scattering will weaken the incident wave in forward direction. Yes, so the reason is the correct explanation for the assertion. So the option is A. 48th question, in PCM, the dynamic signal range and quantization noise are always a design trade-off. Yes, in PCM, reduction in step size will increase the quantization noise. Actually, it will decrease the quantization noise. Hence, this statement is wrong. The suitable option is option C is correct. 49th question, liquid crystal display, LCD, is a high speed display device. Wrong. It is a low speed display device. LED is a high speed display device. Nowadays, the trend is OLED. And the reason what they have specified is LCD consumes low power. Yes, LCD is going to consume low power. So for 49, the answer is D. 51st question, following are the steps that is involved in IC fabrication, you have to arrange in a proper order: crystal growth, epitaxial growth, photo etching, diffusion. So if I am considering the fabrication of a NMOS, what I am going to do is, I am going to take a silicon wafer. To this I am going to add a dopants, nothing but I am going to add a n-type impurity. Then followed by, what I am going to do is, thin layer of SiO2 I am going to just grow. Then upon that, photoresist I'm going to pour. Then I'm going to make a mask. Through this I'm going to pass a UV rays by shading some of the portions. Thereby I'll be getting source region as well as drain region. So these are the pores what I'll be getting. So for this, what I'm going to do is, I'm going to add impurities, that is self regeneration impurities. So this is how I am going to fabricate the IC, nothing but I am going to fabricate the NMOS transistors. So the procedure is, first crystal growth I am going to do, then epitaxial layer, then photo etching, then diffusion. So the suitable option that is going to follow is
1, 2, 3, 4, nothing but option C is correct. 42nd question, you have to arrange the time constants in an increasing order. So we know that time constants is given by tau equals to, in an LR circuit or an RL circuit, it is given by L equivalent divided by R equivalent. In the case of RC circuit, it is given by R times of C, right? So for the first case, I'll be getting L by R. For the second case, what I'll be getting is, I'm having resistance in parallel, nothing but I'll be getting L divided by R by 2, nothing but I'll be getting 2L divided by R. And in the third case, resistance will be in parallel and also inductance will be in parallel. Whenever inductance is in parallel, L by 2 is in parallel with L by 2 and the resistance R in parallel, nothing but R in parallel with R. So what I'll be getting is L by 4 divided by R by 2. So I'll be getting L divided by 2R. L divided by 2R. Fourth case, what I'm having is inductors are in parallel. So fourth case, what I'm having is whenever inductors are in parallel, it is L divided by 2R. L divided by 2R. So increasing order means second one should come at last. The only option that will follow is C option is going to follow, nothing but option C is correct. Once again, I'm telling, in the case of RL circuit, the time constant tau is given by L equivalent divided by R equivalent. In the case of RC circuit, it is given by R equivalent into C equivalent, right? So the first case, you'll be having a resistor, that is R equivalent is R and inductance equivalent is L. So I've written it as L by R. And in the second case, it is R in parallel with another R, nothing but equivalent value of the resistor will be R by 2. So I've written it as R by 2 and L remains the same. And in the third case, both resistors and inductance are in parallel. The inductor value is L by 2 in parallel with L by 2 whole divided by R in parallel with R. So I'll be getting L divided by 2R. And the fourth option also, I'll be getting L divided by 2R. And third option and fourth option, L divided by 2R and L divided by 2R, both are same. So you can't tell it is 4, 3, or if they are given 3, 4 also, they would have been a conflict. So these kind of questions are framed by KSET, and even in NET also you can find this type of questions. 53rd question, the input resistance of a common emitter stage can be increased by, first option, unbypassing emitter resistance. Yes, if you are connecting a resistance across emitter, if you are connecting a resistor over here, this resistance will affect my input impedance, right? Bootstrapping is also going to increase, biasing it at a low quiescent current using compound BJTs, right? This question you have to just go through. Just comment your answer in the comment section. You have to arrange the propagation delay of a logic families in an increasing order. Say CMOS will be having a more propagation delay when compared to all other logic. CMOS should be at last and ECL is the fastest logic. So propagation delay in the case of ECL logic, nothing but emitter coupled logic, should be less. So ECL should be at first, nothing but 3 should come first, followed by last one should be 1. So there is no option as 3. So this is again a wrong question what they have framed. And we know CMOS is the slowest one. So this one, what I can write is, I can write at last. So the only option that is going to follow is option B. Here what they're telling is DTL is faster when compared to ECL, which is a wrong statement. So in the case of CMOS, the propagation delay is of the order of 70 nanoseconds. In the case of I2L logic, it is 30 to 200 nanoseconds. And in the case of ECL, it is 2 nanosecond. And in the case of TTL, it is 10 nanosecond. And in the case of DTL, it is 30 nanoseconds. And in the case of RTL, it is 12 nanoseconds. So based on this, if you are following, none of the option is going to follow. But if I am talking about the CMOS, which is having the more propagation delay, so based on that, I can opt for B. 55th question, what they have given is, they have given the four instruction. You have to tell which one will be consuming more time. If I'm writing move immediate A comma 00H, then what this instruction is going to do is, it is going to load A as 00H.
If I am doing call operation or if I am executing call operation, what is going to happen is the present data register values has to be stored manually. Then the address of the next instruction, which is a called address, has to be loaded, and all my stack pointers, all those things has to be initiated, and then it has to be executed. Nothing but call is the one which will be taking more memory or more time it is going to take. Alt is nothing but temporary stopping, right? LXI, H means memory, H here means HL pair. We know that we are having three registers pair. The first one is BC and the second one is D and the third one is HL pair. So whenever if you want to access memory, you are going to make use of HL register pair, and then you are going to do. So if I want to arrange in a increasing order, it is 1, 2, 3, 4. 56th question, you have to arrange the number of capacitors that is used in an increasing order. The first one is a phase shift oscillator, nothing but it is RC phase shift oscillator. Here we are going to make use of three resistors and three capacitors in a feedback path. A stable multivibrator I have discussed, bistable multivibrator will be used in memory. A stable multivibrator is used for clock generation. And in the case of coffee vending machine, or if you are inserting a coin and it is going to show your weight, no, that kind of things will be realized with the help of monostable multivibrator. Say this one is coffee vending machine, right? So you have to tell the number of capacitors that is used. So for this 56th question, the first one is, in the case of bistable, we are going to make use of less number of capacitors. More number of capacitors will be used in phase shift oscillator. So this feedback connection, if you are knowing, you can solve this problem. So the suitable option that is going to follow is option B is correct. For this 57th question, you have to write the microwave components in a receiver system. So what you'll be having is, first you'll be having the antenna part, followed by you'll be having a low noise amplifier, followed by you'll be having a mixer, and so on. First you'll be having a parabolic antenna, next you'll be having low noise block converter, next you'll be having feed horn, then you'll be having a receiver. So always receiver will be at last. So directly I can eliminate option B. So option C is going to follow. Able to follow? Next, 58th question is based on super heterodyne receiver. In this one, if you are knowing the block diagram of super heterodyne receiver, you can solve this problem. So the super heterodyne receiver, the block diagram consists of, you'll be having an antenna. So antenna is followed with RF amplifier and tuning. You'll be having RF amplifier and tuning. The next block will be you'll be having mixer. Mixer is fed with local oscillator. Followed by, you'll be having IF amplifier. IF amplifier and filter. Followed by, you'll be having a demodulator circuit. Followed by, you'll be having audio amplifier. Last one will be loudspeaker. So in the case of demodulator, you'll be having a simple envelope detector circuit. So demodulator here is envelope detector. So demodulator, what I'm going to use is envelope detector. So based on this, if I'm analyzing, I'll be getting RF stage as first, next comes mixer, next comes IF amplifier, then I'll be getting envelope detector. So based on this, option B is going to follow. 59th question, they have given four detector. First one is phototransistor, second one is avalanche photodiode, the third one is light dependent resistor, the fourth one is PN diode. We know that photodiode is faster when compared to phototransistor, and also this photodiode is very much faster when compared to even LDR also. So this two should be coming at last. Two should be appeared after 1 and 3. So after 1 and 3, 2 is there. After 1 and 3, 2 is not there. So this one I can eliminate. After 1 and 2, 3 is not there, eliminate. So 2 should be after 1 and 3, right? So based on this, if I am following, I'll be getting option D as correct. Nothing but first will be phototransistor, next one will be LDR, third one will be, next one will be PN diode, at last you'll be having avalanche diode. This problems you can solve if you're having depth knowledge. Based on this, if I'm solving, option D is going to follow. 60th question, given the transistors you have to arrange in the increasing order of the linearity, so they have given thermistor, resistor and temperature dependent, and semiconductor strain gauge. Also they have given this potentiometer. We know that semiconductors are highly nonlinear and metals are linear, so first one should be 3, and next one will be a potentiometer, followed by you'll be having RTD, then it is thermistor. So based on this, if I'm writing, option D is going to follow. And one more information if I want to convey, so this RTD, if you want to realize, it is second order polynomial. So you require second order polynomial, but if you want to realize this thermistor characteristics, you require third order polynomial. You require third order polynomial. So based on this, option D is going to follow. 61st question, match the following. They have given BJT, FET, Zener diode and tunnel diode. On the other side, they have given pinch off effect, avalanche breakdown, negative resistance characteristics, punch through effect. So based on this, if I'm mapping, this tunnel diode will be having negative characteristics. So the tunnel diode is having a negative resistance. So D should be 3. So none of the option is there. Only A option is going to follow. So directly I can tell option A is correct. And we know that FET, MOSFET, JFET will be having an impedance of a huge value, and it is having a disadvantage, that is pinch off effect. And Zener diode, avalanche breakdown. BJT suffers from second order effect, that is punch through effect. So based on this, option A is going to follow. 62nd question, they have given the theorems. On the right side, they have given the effects. So we know that Norton theorem is nothing but current source with shunt resistance, nothing but Norton resistance and Thevenin's resistance are dual to each other. So A is getting mapped to 3. A is getting mapped to 3. And B, superposition. Superposition theorem is nothing but additive of each and every response, that is put together. So superposition is effects of independent source in a linear circuit are additive. And Thevenin's theorem is voltage source in series with an impedance, and that impedance can be Thevenin's impedance or Norton's impedance. And Kirchhoff's current law is nothing but law of conservation of charges, nothing but sum of incoming currents should be equals to sum of outgoing currents, or algebraic sum of currents at a node is equals to 0. So based on this, if I'm solving, I'll be getting option A as correct. 63rd question. This question is based on signals. Hardly they are going to ask few questions based on signals. So what they have given is, on the list one, they have given a signal. On the list two, they have differentiated the signal and then they have solved. So the first signal is U of T. U of T, if I'm differentiating, I'll be getting a delta function. The next one is a step signal. If I'm differentiating, I'll be getting this signal. Nothing but one signal and one signal. And if I'm differentiating this one, I'll be getting this one. And if I'm differentiating a triangular one, I'll be getting third one. So based on this, if I'm solving, I'll be getting C option as correct. Able to follow? And 64th question is a bit tricky question. They have given shift register, 4-bit counter, ring counter, multivibrator. This multivibrator can be an astable, monostable or bistable also. On the list 2, they have given clock generator, divide by n counter, stepper motor and decimal counter. So in the case of stepper motor, what you are going to do is alternate coils you are going to excite. Nothing but first case, if I want to rotate in a clockwise direction, these two coils I am going to energize. Next case, these two coils I am going to energize. Next case, these two I am going to energize. Next case, these two I am going to energize. So shift register is stepper motor. Shift register is stepper motor. 4-bit counter is a decimal counter. 4-bit counter means a decimal counter. Multivibrator means clock generation. Multivibrator means clock generation. They are telling a ring counter. See, they are mapping it to 2. Nothing but divide by n counter. Nothing but modulus of a ring counter. Modulus of a ring counter is n. And modulus of Johnson counter is 2n. Maximum modulus of a Johnson counter is 2n. So this ring counter, I don't know how they have mapped to divide by n counter. So this is a bit tricky one. So based on this, if I am solving, I'll be getting option A as correct. 65th question. Again, you have to match the following. Register B. We know that general purpose registers are A, B, C, D, H, L. And HL is a memory pointer. Register PC. PC is going to store the next instruction that to be executed. Stack means it is going to follow last in first out or first in last out. Based on this, if I am following, I'll be getting option B as correct answer. 66th question. Random of rand max. It is nothing but random number generator. A star means it is a pointer, so it is pointer to an array. And again, this one, if I am mapping, I'll be getting UNGETC. It is nothing but returning either a character or EOF. Int long y equals to, if I am writing equals to, then it would have been a correct statement. And int and long, no need to declare both the one. Either you declare it as int or either you can declare it as long. If you are declaring both int and long, it is an illegal declaration. And colon is again one more illegal. So for B, it is 1. So based on this, if I'm mapping, I'll be getting option C as correct. So 67th question, you have to perform match the following. Pin diode. So they have given this pin diode. Pin diode is used for microwave amplification. So this pin diode is for microwave amplification and gallium arsenide is for switching. Gallium arsenide is for switching and this klystron they have given. Klystron is a microwave source. So klystron is a microwave source and this varector diode is used for tuning. Varector diode is used for tuning. Varector diode means a diode followed by a capacitor. Say if I want to change the frequency, frequency is given by 1 divided by 2 pi. Root LC, let me consider. So this entire frequency I can change by varying L or I can vary by C. If I want to change by L, it is a tedious task. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to change the voltage. Based on change in voltage, I'm going to change the capacitance. In turn, frequency is varied. In turn, frequency is varied. So for this option is D is going to follow. Option D is going to follow. 68th question. They have given compounding, aliasing, pre-emphasis and down conversion. On the list they have given super 80 rod drain receiver, boosting of high frequency components, overlapping of sidebands and non-uniform quantization. We know that aliasing occurs whenever there is a overlapping of higher frequency components with a lower frequency components. So in order to prevent this aliasing, what we are going to do is we are going for Nyquist sampling or oversampling. Next, pre-emphasis means boosting of higher frequency components mainly to maintain signal to noise ratio greater than 1. To maintain signal to noise ratio greater than 1. Down conversion we are going to use for super 80 rod drain receiver. Down conversion we are going to prefer for super 80 rod drain receiver. At the time here we are going to talk about intermediate frequency, that is 455 kilohertz. So for 1 it is down conversion and for compounding it is non-uniform quantization and for compounding it is non-uniform quantization. Hence option A is going to follow. 69th question. Again, you have to match the following. DC to DC, we are going to call or we are going to achieve by a chopper circuit. AC to DC, it is a rectification and it is done by a rectifier circuit and the process is called as rectification. AC to AC, it is cycloconverters and DC to AC, we know it is achieved by inverter. So for this 69, the option that is going to follow is option number D is correct. 70th question, again match the following. This LVDT topic is very, very important. This LVDT is for linear displacement measurement and moving coil type. Moving coil type is for velocity measurement, and this Bourdon tube is for pressure measurement. And this Bourdon tube is for pressure measurement, and this thermopile is for radiation. What this thermopile is going to do is, if you are having heat radiation, this heat radiation is converted to voltage. This heat radiation is converted to voltage with the help of this thermopile. So based on this, if I am matching, I'll be getting the option as option C is going to follow. So 71st question to 75th question is based on transmission line. So this is the part of EMTL. Please go through it, pause the video and go through the theory behind it. First question, what they have given is, when an electromagnetic wave propagates through an open circuited transmission line, when it reaches the open circuited end, what is the condition on voltage and what is the condition on current? So voltage will be maximum and current will be minimum. So voltage will be maximum and current will be minimum. So based on this, option B is going to follow. 72nd question, the input impedance of a lambda by 4 short circuited transmission line of a characteristic impedance Z naught, which is given by 100 ohms is. So we need to calculate input impedance. So input impedance is given by Z naught times of tan of beta L. So Z naught equals to 100. So Z naught equals to 100 into tan of what is beta? Beta is 2 pi by lambda into what is the length? Length they have given it as lambda by 4. You'll be getting pi by 2. What is tan pi by 2? Tan pi by 2 is infinite. So you'll be getting option C. Or what is one more method? We know that Z in, nothing but input impedance, is given by Z naught square divided by ZL. What is Z naught square, which is 100 square, divided by what is ZL, which is equals to 0. So I'll be getting Z in, which is equals to infinite. So I'll be getting Z in equals to infinite. 73rd question, the voltage reflection coefficient of a transmission line terminated by characteristic impedance. So they have given the line is terminated by a characteristic impedance. Whenever it is terminated by a characteristic impedance, at that time there will be no any reflection. The reflection coefficient is zero. The primary constants of a transmission line is RL, G and C. In a lossless transmission line, one can neglect. You can neglect series resistance and shunt conductance. In this video, I have discussed all 75 questions. To extend your love and support, please like the video, share this video with your friends, and don't forget to subscribe to my channel Craning Gyan. Also join my Telegram group. If you are having any queries, ping me a mail to craninggyan@gmail.com. All the best for your exams. Thank you.